All right, welcome back. It's still the breakfast on Plus TV Africa. We'll be looking at something differently right now. A bill for an act to make provisions for the empowerment of women and gender equality to establish a legislative framework for the women divided lawmakers during plenary after being read for the second time on Wednesday. Now, some lawmakers are of the opinion that some sections and aspects of the law and its implementation conflict with the belief of some groups in the country. We have joining us right now, Barrister Rita Ilevere. She's joining us from AKT and she will be looking at this issue with us. Good morning to you, Barrister Ilevere.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for having me on the show.
All right. It seems as though this particular issue may not be seen the green light after all. This is like the second time the Senate has actually, you know, pushed it away. You know, it happened also the 8th Assembly, and right now it caused a bit of an uproar yesterday at plenary with some lawmakers being divided over this particular issue. You know, one of the issues stems from the fact that some section of the country, you know, are not really in tune with this. So would you say, if I have to put it this way, that the issue of religion, you know, actually hampers women from getting, you know, to their ultimate or to their optimum?
Well, to put the record straight, this is actually the third time, not the second time. The bill came up in the 7th Assembly, the 8th Assembly, and now again. I will not really say that, of course, we know we have a lot of religious and cultural practices that hindered the growth and development and even impugned on the right of women. But religion itself, it depends on the way we practice religion. It is the nomenclature that we give to religion that's the face that religion projects. I would just say that Senator Olujimi and all gender advocates and all women, the he for she in Nigeria, we are not deterred. It took 14 years for us to get the Violence Against Prohibition bills to become law in Nigeria. It is just for us to go back to the drawing board and re-strategize.
When you say you're going back to the drawing board to re-strategize, what exactly do you think you can do differently? Like you have rightly said, this is the third time in a series that this particular bill has been rejected. Is it that it is not really important for the nation?
It is very, very important for the nation. Series of studies have established that for sustainable development goals, women and men, boys and girls, we have to come to the development table. And now it is not in doubt that in Nigeria in particular, we have so many hindrances, ranging from sociocultural practice, religious practice, even some of our laws are discriminatory. So the importance of this law cannot be overemphasized. It is very, very important. But like I said before, we will keep pushing. We will also not forget the very important leave no one behind and be all-inclusive, or the mantra of the SDG. We will consult widely and see what we can do to also ensure that the law and the bill eventually see the light of the day. We will consult widely, more sensitization. It is sad, it is a sad one, but it is not the end of the road. Like I said, it's an opportunity for us to look inward and see those things we can do better. Probably those who are even not so comfortable with this bill, they do not understand what this bill is all about. Remember, series of challenges like this crop up when child's rights law was going well, or the advocacy for child's rights be to become a law in Nigeria, even the Violence Against Prohibition Persons Act. But as of today now, almost 32 states have key into the VAP Act. So it is not a journey of a day, but we keep progressing.
All right. Let's also ask you now, the fact that you actually advocate for women's involvement in, you know, the different sphere of our endeavor in Nigeria, how would you rate, you know, women's representation in politics and in other endeavors in Nigeria?
Hello, I didn't quite get that. Can you call again?
So I say that you are someone who's been advocating women inclusiveness in governance amongst others. The question is, how would you measure women's inclusiveness or involvement in governance in Nigeria?
Women's inclusiveness is still at a very, very, it's still very, very low in Nigeria. You can't believe that in this time and age, there are some states of House of Assembly that we have no woman, not even a single woman at the State House of Assembly. But by and large, I think the consciousness is very high now. For me, that is to take a lot of women are conscious and they have been developed, they have undergone series of training, interaction, sensitization. And I think in the next dispensation that we will see a lot of women coming on board into political space and decision making. It is very, very unfortunate that this attempt to ensure that we have a law to really back up this has been stepped down. But being that as it may, like I said, sensitization and consulting wise, we will continue to sensitize, we will continue to engage, but there is no doubt about the fact that where we are in Nigeria with women in public places and in political spaces and decision making is still very, very low. We really need to do better in Nigeria. And like we say, if women can't even get this come into governance through elective position, at least we can have women mainstream into places of governance, into decision making by appointment. I take, for example, in Ekiti State now, there are really a lot of appointments deliberately making women to come into political, into decision making space. Like the Ministry of Justice in Ekiti State, when this President, Attorney General, Honorable Lawale Fakonda SAN came to become the Honorable Attorney General, there were not a lot of women at the directorate level. What the Attorney General then did was to ensure that a lot of women were given specific assignment and appointment, making them essays and all that. And by that, even though these women by the cadre of civil service, they were not yet directorate cadre, but because they were essay to the Attorney General on one portfolio on the other, they were now into the decision-making cadre of the Ministry of Justice. And that's what the whole essence of gender mainstreaming is all about. So whether law or no law, we can say that the political will desire to ensure that a deliberate attempt is made, a path is created to ensure that women come into decision-making position, either by elective, by appointment. It just has to be a conscious effort. And I want to say that, yes, the law is very, very good, but we should not also forget that the law is not an end in itself. Why? We are still pushing to get the law. We still need to ensure that people shift their mindset, people get to understand that what we are talking about is not about it's not about women and men in competition, but just that women have potential, men have potential that needs to be harnessed together for the good of the society, for the development for the society, and for the benefit of all.
All right. It's good that you have mentioned that, because I was wondering now if we actually as a country need a law to ensure that women, get their rightful places in the course of things, because there's been so much talk, there's this 35% affirmative action, School of Thought even believes that women are better economic managers. If we know all of this, would you say that women are actually pushing themselves forward? Are they supporting each other? Is there like a forum? They have to ensure that their voice or their voices are heard as one in the play of things in Nigeria.
Of course, women are supporting each other. The umbrella body of women group in Nigeria is the National Council for Women Society. It's made up of all women group, the subgroup. Of course, you have the International Federation of Women Lawyers. You have NAWOJ, that is the arm for women journalists. You have the Medical Women Association, and so on and so forth. Women have been able to organize themselves at different fora, be it local government, be it state, and be it national. But the mother body of all women organizations in Nigeria is the National Council for Women Society. And the beautiful thing about the National Council for Women Society is that the council is not leaving any women behind. It comprises of women who are educated, rural women, every organization that is women-focused, that is women-inclined, are all members of National Council for Women Society. It is at this level, collectively and in the national forum, that women organize, women sensitize themselves, and women engage. But beyond the National Council, we have some women group, like I mentioned, the International Federation of Women Lawyers, FIDA, who is also in the forefront, and so many other organizations. Beyond all this, we also have non-governmental organizations that do very, very well in different aspects of ensuring that women come to the fore. It is just a conspiracy of the society that says that women are not supporting themselves. Women are supporting themselves. It is just a creation of the society to further divide women and say women do not support themselves. If you have been following our neighbor and wife of governor of Ekiti State, if you have read her book, The Rapper, women have been rappers to themselves from ages, right from our great-great-grand, from time immemorial. But society reinvented the wheel and tried to say that women does not support themselves. If we don't support ourselves, who are we going to be supporting? Women support themselves, women support their husbands, women support their children, women support their brother, women support everybody. And that's why the popular saying that when you empower a woman, you are actually empowering a nation. Because a woman, when a woman is in a position of authority, or when a woman has any ability, any skills, anything that a woman has, a woman thinks of everybody.
Okay, so I really don't know how far we have fed. You have mentioned in the course of this discourse that, you know, women's representation in election, appointing office, inclusion in election and what have you is not fair. So about 25 years after, you know, signing, being part of that declaration and saying we're going to have 35%, I don't know how much we have worked, all of the groups and bodies advocating for, you know, women's inclusion, how far we have ensured that that law is implemented, because it feels like it's a problem of implementation. I'd also like to ask you, how far do you think that this current administration has done in terms of giving women, you know, that, you know, position in governance? I mean, for instance, you would remember that the president made that promise during his campaign that 40% would be given to, he would allocate 40% to women, appointment of women in his cabinet. So what are your thoughts on that?
My thought is that this present administration can actually do better. Of course, we have pockets of appointments of women here and there. It is not enough. I don't know the statistics now, so that I don't go and say what it is not. But just looking around, many times we are looking at women who have come to decision-making and governance in this administration. I personally believe that this administration can do better.
All right, just before we go, I just want to put one question very quickly. Let me just try and squeeze that in. You know, so over time now, how soon do you think we can get from this place of Africa or Nigeria specifically being a patriarchal, you know, society to a place where we might have a female governor or maybe a president sometime soon?
It's not something that we can put a time limit to. More so, we do not have the required legislation to back that up. But one thing that is certain, that it is nearer than we think. We are not where we want to be, but we are not exactly where we started from. Like I said, the consciousness is very, very high. Like, you know, the political activities are gearing up in the state now. Already, about 7 women have indicated their interest to vie for the governorship position. We have not seen it like that before. 7 women, and we are still counting. So we are getting nearer there. I know that sooner than we expected, we are going to have a female governor, or who knows, even a female president.
All right, we'll keep our fingers crossed and expect to see that day very soon. A very big thank you to you, Rita Elevary. She is a lawyer, a gender advocate, and coordinator, AKDS Sexual Awareness Referral Center. Many thanks for your thought and your opinion on the show this morning.
Well, it's been an amazing
Assault Referral Center, actually.
All right, sexual assault. Thanks for the correction. All right, we do appreciate your time so much, sir.
Well, that's the much we can actually take. But, you know, on the other hand, I'm just wondering, we constantly say we want to have a female president and governor. That can happen until we begin to implement the little agreement that we were part of over 25 years ago. We haven't seen, you know, 35% affirmation. And then we're looking forward to having...
I want to see you as a governor very soon from your state.
That can
see my fingers crossed. That's the size of the show for today. My name is Justin Akadonye.
And I am Mercy Boko. If you missed out on any part of the conversation, it's all right to follow us on Facebook. And of course, Instagram is at Plus TV Africa. And on YouTube, do subscribe as a Plus TV Africa Lifestyle. Do have a wonderful morning.
Madam Governor, bye for now.